Hey everybody, thanks for being here. This week, we're fishing the Columbia River above Bonneville Dam for hard-fighting smallmouth bass with Tom Hartshorn and Cameron Black. If you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television. By the middle of October, water temps have cooled significantly, triggering the fish to feed. But this year's start to fall has been a warm one, meaning we might have to do a little searching and experimenting to figure out the bite.
All right, plan here today is we are fishing the Columbia River here in October for some late season smallmouth. I've got the guru Tom Hartshorn with me today, who's been kind of my mentor in all this bass fishing stuff, and we're gonna go try to catch some big ones. The fish should be on the fall feed right now. Temps are cooling down, which triggers these fish to bite. So we're out here just to have a good morning and to see what we can find.
We're out here just to try to see what we can find today. It should be a good day. The fish have been pretty much on the chomp and chewing here of late.
So water temp's still mid to low 60s, which we've had an unseasonably warm year. So we've been expecting these fish to go on the real big chomp, like kind of that, you know, mid-September or so when things have cooled down, but we've had an Indian summer. So we're out here mid-October, and it looks like the water temps are still going to be warm, so we're going to get up here and fish a little bit shallow and see what we can find.
Yeah, I'd move up towards that rock pile up there because it's underwater. Personally, I would start up here and sitting about 17 feet where the rock pile is covered right now. Those fish should start moving up there to feed off the crawdads moving out. So that should be a good way to start it.
Oh, I just have a few, a couple left. So that's actually what that is for.
Is that trophy bass?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Probably my favorite out of all the Procure stuff, is that trophy bass. That and crawfish.
So we're gonna start with a jig. Like Tom said, you know, these fish are feeding on crayfish and stuff, but I always take a little bit of, I always have a container with me. Always have a little bit of scent added to your jig because make these fish hold on a little longer, give you a little longer chance at getting a bite, or getting a little longer chance to get a hook in them, I should say. We're gonna start working our way up just alongside this edge here and see if we can find some up shallow today.
Swim bait. I'm just throwing a Kitec, 4-3 Kitec swim bait and Tennessee shad. Just see if there's anything reactive in the area. Let's see if anything can bite. I think the closer we get up to those rocks, the better it will be. The reaction bite on this. It's one of my favorite ways to find fish really fast and slow down and start going through it with a jig and a drop shot. Hopefully one of us will get hooked up quick. Little rat up there. Okay. During the summer, all the fish have been pretty much out in the deeper breaks and out deeper and anywhere from, oh, I would say 20 to 25 feet. We've been catching them 30 feet. Now they're trying to get into that transition of the fall feed. The water temperatures are starting to drop. So it should change the fish over to the fall transition to get fattened up for the winter time. That's why we're trying to work this little shallow break up here and see if they're moving up. And once they start moving up, it'll change the way the bite and the bigger fish will start playing a lot more friendly.
Welcome back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're targeting smallmouth bass in early fall, which can be fantastic for both numbers and big fish as long as you're fishing the structure correctly.
You can see the rock pile here, all to our right side, you know, our 1 o'clock, all the way to our, well, actually back behind it now.
Yeah. Probably best to be on the front side of the rock pile. In my past experiences, fish tend to position themselves more to the front for the current coming through it. So when something sweeps down, it's easier for them to grab at it instead of sitting behind it all the time. And it doesn't take much of a break for a fish to sit behind.
Oh, shocker, Tom got one.
Nah, I'll swing him. Maybe. Nah, he's not that big.
Yeah, that's a good start.
Yeah, nice start.
4 pounder.
So, I was throwing my swim bait and I wasn't getting what I wanted on the swim bait. So I picked up a jig to get it down towards the bottom a little bit better. And on my second cast, caught this nice little chunk. So.
Did everybody else have the 3 pounder?
A 5-inch hula grub, 176 color. And these are my own football jig heads that I pour with a flat eye. My favorite all-around bait to throw. Yeah, I thought he was going to be bigger than that the way he started fighting. Yeah, he did. Oop. Okay, you just let it go. Oh, he didn't. Another.
This is going to be embarrassing for me today. I already know it.
I don't know what this guy's.
Yeah, it is.
This guy's not that big and he's fighting like he's big.
We got the right water temperature today. He's got a friend with him.
Good Lord. Has he got a friend with him?
I don't know. I can't tell. The water's so dark.
Dark, yes.
A lot
not
of times
that big. But
here.
He's sure fighting like he's big. He's probably bigger than I think. Get in the boat. Boy, you choked that thing. Another nice chunk. That one's a better chunk. But switching over the jig sometimes can just make all the difference in the world. Two casts, three casts with a jig, two fish. Can't beat that. It's awesome. Now let's put this big boy back and let him grow up.
So one thing, October is always an interesting month up here in the gorge because the forecast called for, I think, 1.2 miles an hour today. Here it is blowing 15 because you always got to be ready to come to the Columbia River Gorge and you always have to be prepared for wind. Be prepared to launch somewhere else, you know, maybe get to the ramp and, you know, a lot of times you can kind of adjust locations and move, but, you know, the wind's going to prevent us from going to a lot of the areas that we really want to go today, but we've still got a nice spot here to fish and it's still obviously fishable, well, at least for Tom anyways.
Keep my heads right here and my favorite grubs just like that. These are probably the only three I ever throw. Once in a while, I'll throw this color, but mostly the 176, 330, and 331. My favorite colors here on the Columbia River. You just, kind of like the old saying goes, just don't leave home without them because they will catch fish and they will put fish in your boat. But what I'm tying here is a typically called the Palomar knot. Really simple. I'm gonna start all over with it. I mean, it's the most basic knot. Put the line through the eye like that, pull it out, put it back through, then pull it to like this, just make an overhand knot, and pull the jig right back through the knot, do that, and then the gross part, slobber all over it so it doesn't burn your line, and you probably have the strongest knot and easiest to tie in any condition that you can possibly get. So when I hook these up, I try to hold this like this, put my hook point right dead in the middle. Isn't always perfect. And just slide it up I run exposed hook with these baits and just run it down to almost the tail and slide it up, and should look pretty much just like that. And these fish love to chomp it.
Welcome to the Angler West Shop here in Woodland, Washington. Now we're going to go back to the Columbia River and catch a few more smallmouth. But first, I want to talk to you a little bit about the reels that we're using in today's episode, where we're casting jigs for the most part for smallmouth bass. Now we're using what's called a bait caster or a conventional style reel. The problem with bait casters, particularly with new fishermen, and I see this all the time, the guys come in the shop, they don't have good luck casting a bait caster for the first time, right? They buy a reel, they put line on it, they take it out and get a big bird's nest, right? Well, what I want to do is take a few minutes to show you how you can prevent that a little bit by how you set up your reel with your line, and then also how you tune the reel to prevent those bird nests from happening so badly. Now, first of all, when we're talking about lines, you've got braided lines, and then you've got lines like the monofilaments. You've got something like the CXX, which is very tough with just a little bit of stretch. And then also softer lines like the FluoroClear from P-Line, which is nice and soft and not so much memory. Well, what do we mean by memory? Okay, a braided line has very little memory because it's basically a cloth line, right? So it doesn't remember very well how it was on the spool. You take that off and it's not going to keep those curls in it so much. Whereas a stiff, hard line like the CXX, which is extremely strong and powerful and very little stretch, it has more memory. It's going to remember how it was curled up on that spool. So when you take it off, you're going to see those curls in it a little bit more. So you got to learn how to manage that. And then for the FluoroClear, it's a very soft line, doesn't have much memory at all. Put a lot of this on spinning reels, but if you're starting out, I would recommend spooling up the first time with a nice soft line like this on your bait caster, because it's going to be a lot easier to cast. The only disadvantage is you're going to have a line that's not quite as tough and has a little more stretch, but you're also going to be able to cast a lot easier, and you're probably going to have more fun and catch more fish regardless, and you can always, you know, next time spool up with some CXX or something like that. What you want to do when you're putting your line on your reel for the first time is make sure that the line's being spooled up onto your reel the same way that it was on the spool originally. It's like a garden hose or an electrical cord. You know, they come wound up, and if you unwind them and try to wind them back up in the opposite way, they just turn into a big mess. Well, it's the same thing with a fishing line. Okay, you want to get them onto your spool the same way that they're wound onto their original spool. Now, once you have the line on there, and make sure it's very tightly put on there too, that's important. Whether it's braided line, which is what I have on this particular reel, or the mono, okay, what I like to do always, and I'll do this with the guys here in the shop that come in, I put line on their reels, and I'll have them walk down to the end of the shop here with the line, and we'll stretch that line. We'll peel a bunch of line off the spool here, stretch it, and then reel it back up nice through your fingers, right, to get those loops out of there. So it's all nice and straight and perfect on your spool. So when you start casting, that's gonna help not get so many little mess ups with your spool. Okay, so how do you tune your reel to get less twist in your line? So what we're gonna do is, just for demonstration purposes, I've got a 1 ounce lead tied on the line here. So I'm just gonna drop that down here. There's two control mechanisms on the win. Okay, this is called the mag force, or it's a magnetic brake basically, that if you crank it all the way down, it's gonna add tension to the spool to keep it from trying to overrun. And now as you get more accomplished, you can adjust this, or you're casting different weights, or you're casting into the wind, or whatever. You can adjust this, the little magnets in there, just by turning this dial. But when you're first starting out,
take this and put it on, there's numbers on here, and just put it on number 10, crank it all the way down. Okay, now on this side, you've got your spool tension control, this round knob right here. We're gonna tighten that all the way down. So I've got the mag force spool tightened down and this tightened down. So when I click the thumb bar here, it's not gonna let the spool go. Everything's tightened down tight. So it's your drag system here to make sure that you don't overrun. But that's far too tight. You wouldn't be able to cast with that very well. Now I've got that 1 ounce of lead hanging off of there. Now watch this. I'm gonna pull down the thumb bar. Without my thumb on it, I'm gonna release some of this tension off the spool tensioner, and you'll see it start to turn, and boom, that lead just hit the floor and didn't overrun on the spool. So that means it's set correctly for that amount of weight. Okay, so then I can take it and I can start make a little pitch with it, and there's no overrun. So then what I wanna do is keep loosening that up a little bit to where it's nice and comfortable and I can get some distance and not get any overrun. Now, I was using my thumb there, and that's the key though. You're trying to get to where you're using your thumb instead of this at all, really. You know, guys that are really good at this, they have their mag force on zero, and this is all the way loose, and they're just using their thumb. Okay, well, don't think you gotta do that right away. You take this out to the grass, you know, some pond somewhere or somewhere you don't even necessarily need to be fishing, but just go in your backyard or somewhere and just start pitching underhand, all right? And just don't, to where you can do that without getting overrun. Don't feel like you need to get out there and cast overhand to begin with. You know, that takes a little bit of practice. And when you do start casting overhand, make sure you're using your mag force and your spool tensioner, and start nice and slow and just release that a little bit until you get the hang of it and you get the hang of using your thumb. Because at some point, you're gonna be using your thumb only to control your spool. And that's the whole key and the little secret to it. So once you figure that out, it really opens up all your possibilities for really the benefits of using this type of reel. Because until you learn how to cast and get it set up right, they can be more of a problem than are worth, really. But once you get it figured out, you're gonna catch a lot of fish with these reels. I hope this has been helpful to you, and if you'd like to see more videos like this, go to the Angler West YouTube channel and be sure to subscribe. There's lots of videos, plus most of the past episodes. Now, up next, we're going back to the Columbia River to do a little more smallmouth bass fishing.
Back to the Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. Jigs smeared with Procure Super Gels are producing some quality fish for Tom Hartshorn and Cameron Black. The forecast called for calm winds, but the Columbia River Gorge doesn't care about the forecast. It does what it wants, and today it wants the wind to blow, and to blow us so hard it will push us off the river early.
He's doing more wind management, dragging along rocks. Little guy wants to grab it. It surprised me. Well, at least expect it. Maybe that's the only way I'm gonna hook him today.
Trying to feel the rock, basically. Once I feel the rock, then I can just let that jig just sit there and move slowly. Try to get a trick bass into thinking a crawdad, trying to move around down there. So, clean the weeds off. Yeah, we picked kind of a good day, but the wind didn't want to cooperate today. So we were looking at the weather forecast coming in here and called for 1 mile an hour winds, and looks like we've got about 15. So, but typical of the Columbia River, never believe the forecast. You get what you get when you get out here. But still one of the best fisheries, I think, in the United States. Right, for me, it rates right up there with Lake Erie, the St. Lawrence River, some of the stuff back east. And we're very fortunate to have this in our backyard. So, there's an old saying, and I kind of buy into it in this area. When the wind's out of the west, the fish bite the best. When the wind's out of the east, the fish bite the least. My experience is it seems to hold pretty true for me. Now, just saying that, but it's an old saying. It's been around for probably as long as I have, and I'm almost 70, so for I have no idea. I don't know the rhymes and reasons behind it, but it seems to have always hold true for me. And it would really, oh shoot, I had a fish for a second, sorry. I lost my train of thought, but yeah, it's one of them things that when that east wind blows here, it seems to hold really true to me. Nice thing about the gorge here though is sometimes you can go further upriver and get out of the wind and get back into the fish, but down on the lower pool here, it seems to shut the bite down a little bit for the bigger fish. Little fish, I don't think care anything. They just want to eat. Well, it's kind of hard to say right now. I'm trying to figure them out. These were just two quick little bites. Typically, they're usually there, especially over the years I've noticed with bigger fish. You don't want to hesitate because they'll spit that bait out at you really fast. So, but that one, it just felt weird and took off my tail. So you got part of me. I'll change out baits and go back after them again.
Chill down to the boat.
Boom.
Good fish.
Just ate it. Oh my goodness.
He choked it.
Yeah. You can tell they're on the feed when they're doing that.
Might be a tough bite, but still, when they're eating like that, and he's taking that whole grub in, I'm still gonna catch him. Look at that though, you can tell like this fall time, see how fat that fish is. Super healthy, super aggressive.
You know, she ain't missing any meals right now, that's for sure.
Hey everybody, thanks for watching today's episode. And be sure to stop by the Angler West store in Woodland, Washington. I'm sure we can help you catch more fish. And remember, without the sponsors, there is no show. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.